Dear colleagues and guests, it is my pleasure to invite among us Professor Leitgeb from Graz University. Professor Leitgeb is a very famous scientist and key specialist in Austria in problematics of microwave technologies and fiberless communication technologies, and I hope that his today's lesson will be very interesting for us.
Professor Vazhenek, thanks a lot for your nice invitation, and thanks to all of you for coming to this lecture in holidays time. Yeah. And we know, I think, first time we met 10 years ago or something,
yeah, yeah.
And then a year later, and then I think we lost in between, yeah. But I'm really happy to be here
yeah.
again.
Yeah.
Yes? And thanks for coming, and thanks for your nice welcome. As mentioned, it is really a pleasure that I'm here today, and I hope you will enjoy my presentation and not too much to disturb your holidays. At the beginning, I have splitted my lecture in three parts. The first part is called introduction part, but in this part I will mainly show what we are doing in principle, and later in the second part I will show the atmospheric effects on optical wireless, and on the third part some of our main work we have done in the past time, fog and cloud measurements, mainly fog measurements, and one colleague in Canada, you know him, Steve Radilovich. He mentioned when he visited me in Graz, he said to my colleagues when we discussed it, yes, yes, I know, Aries Group is the foggiest group in Europe. So that is the third part of our lectures, some details on fog measurements. The first part would need, I think, the longest time, perhaps 1 hour 15 or something. The second part, perhaps 1 hour, and the last part is the shortest one. So we will have, if possible, if it is not too exhausting, we will have a short break after all the parts. Yes. And at the beginning, I will give you a rough overview about our institute where I belong to at the University of Technology in Graz. As mentioned, since 2010, we have a new institute called this Institute of Microwave and Photonic Engineering, where also the photonic and optical part belongs to this institute. And before, I was located on the Institute of Broadband Communication. So if you see on some older publications, the Institute of Broadband Communication, I was before there, but this one was closed at the end last year, as they moved people around to other institutes. You know, some reorganizations on all the universities we have in Europe. It is happening everywhere, we know that, yes. And so I will show you at first, because before this Institute of Broadband Communication, we have been a very big department. Professor Riedler was a very, he's retired now since 2000. He gave still lectures till 2 years ago. Yes. He's very old now. But when he left, then also the first step was done in this reorganization and reconstruction of the universities. They told us you are autonomous and independent, but that means you will not longer access a lot of money from the government side. Yes, and that happens in 2000, and then we were splitted. This big department were splitted in these three institutes you see here. Yes, and as mentioned, this one, the Institute of Broadband Communication, where I belonged, this one was closed now end of 2014 finally. Yes. And the other two institutes, they are still exist, Institute of Signal Processing, there's Professor Kubin, perhaps somebody knows him, and the Institute of Communication Networks and Satellite Communications. All of this one is existing. The professor there is Professor, we pronounce it wrong, we say Professor Kudelka, but in principle it is Professor Kudelka, because his name is from origin a Czechian name, yes, a Bohemian name, yes, but we pronounce it wrong in our institute, because it's very interesting. when I was a young assistant, the professor of the neighbor institute, he always said, he was in the conservatory, he always said, Kudelka. Why does he not know the exact name of the colleague? But then later I found out that he pronounced it correct, yes? Only we pronounced it not correct, yes? Incorrect. That's very interesting. And as mentioned, in this Institute of Broadband Communication, there have been three groups. And when this new Institute of Microwave and Photonic Engineering were established, then of course two groups were much better suited to this institute. It was the optical group, led by myself, and the radar group, or microwave group, led by a professor who also retired now, 2 years ago, yes. But these two groups came to the Institute of Microwave and Photonic Engineering. And so here we are in this Institute of Microwave and Photonic Engineering, and we have still three groups there: the general microwave technology, the optical communications, and the radar and microwave propagation. Yes, these are the three groups we have. At the moment we have two professors, the head of our institute and myself, and three younger postdocs paid by the global, by the direct global university budget, and one postdoc paid by the project, and all the rest are project scientists and PhD students and so on. Yes, and of course also some mechanical engineers for lab and so on. Yes, that is the institute we have at the moment. And as mentioned, of course, that is also of interest, we had also at the same time, when we had this reorganization of the universities, we had also started with this reorganization of all these study programs. Yes, I think you have the same here in your country, because before we had the diploma engineer, yes, and then they wanted to come with this bachelor master system, yes, and that was a long, because on some faculties they were very early, on others they were very delayed, yes. So at the end, I think now, I think nearly 100% of all the study programs in the bachelor master program, yes, but before we had the diploma engineer. But it has not changed so much, yes, but in principle, because of this different structure, I think the quality of the students coming out has become worse, yes. I think that is the result, yes, because we have to learn them the same, but in other programs, yes, and so I think at the end the quality is not so good like we had before, yes, but it was necessary to have this bachelor master program like the European Union wishes. And as example, Austria is always usual a country who is very quick. If European Union says that, then they doing this very quick. As other example, but that is perhaps a worse example, in Greece, they are very delayed in this case, yes. Because when I, as example, when I made Erasmus lecture in Patras, then we had, I think nearly half of the programs has been changed to bachelor master, and in Greece they started discussion on it, yes. And then there was a big, like a student revolution, because they said, and also the teacher, we will not do this, yes? And so I'm not sure what has happened, but then the difference. Austria is always very quick, in my mind, too quick to follow the European Union. It would sometimes be better to wait a little bit, yes? And but other countries like Greece, they are too late. It's also not the best. So the way in between would be a good way, I think. And also, of course, the lecture and the presentation I will give today, mainly on optical wireless, is also a very old tradition in Graz, because when I write there 15 years of experience, then this is calculated from this time when I got the assistant, when I after my post at the postdoc position, yes. But of course, also under my PhD, I have done some work, and my four runners also have done work on this. And the reason was also because I think you have the same situation in your country. You are also the second or the third in your country, yes? The first University of Technology is in Prague, yes? So most of the money, I think, will go to Prague. It is the same with the European Union projects, yes? Most of the European projects are somewhere to find near Brussels, yes? Because they have short ways to Brussels, yes? But if I say that to officials, they will say, no, no, that's not true, that's not true. But it is, yes? And it is the same. Graz is not the biggest city in Austria, it's the second largest city only, yes? So of course, a lot or the most money is always located near Vienna. Yes, that is the point, and I think it's the same with your country. Yes, and that was the reason why we mainly concentrated at this time on optical wireless, because fiber optics was well established. Yes, there you must have a lot of money to be on the front somewhere, on the first place. Yes. So we concentrated more on this optical wireless. That was the history why we had this optical wireless in our focus so early when we started with this work. Yes. And of course, also that is a point, mainly we had international corporations. Because in Austria, there's nearly no company really interested in optical communication. There's no fiber company, because all the big companies, they have at minimum perhaps some outpost somewhere in Austria, some filiale, yeah? But not the main center. They are perhaps in Germany or US or somewhere. So it is the problem that nearly no interest, yes, is in Austria for optical communications in general, yes, and optical wireless, not much interest. Yes. Also at the moment we have in Austria this from the government side, from the Ministry of Innovation and Traffic and Technology, we have this broadband initiative, so that everybody should have access at minimum for 10 or 100 megabit, yes, also in some mountainous and rural areas, yes, but I think that is only this fund, this available fund is perhaps only to give money to the telecom providers to make cables to the cities and the larger villages perhaps, but not to the small villages. So it would be the same. It's a good name, yes, a sexy name, broadband initiative, yes, but I think it will also not bring much for our research. So that is the point why we have mainly these international corporations like cost, we will see later. Also the actual cost, they are old cost actions, very old. And there was also some European Union project long time ago, this satellite of network of excellence, as this happens. It was a very, in principle, very fruitful cooperation, fruitful program, but it was also too short and too small part only for optical wireless. And we had only a chance that it was a big project and a small part was in the optical wireless, together with two or three other colleagues from other countries. As mentioned, we will start with this introduction part, and in this introduction part I will show mainly what we are doing. Yes, a little bit about the principles. All of you are in the optic field or some other colleagues also here. All optics.
From optics.
So I hope it's not too redundant some parts, but you know, if you hear it from some other, it is hopefully more interesting if you do it by yourself or something. So, okay, all of you are familiar or are working in the optical wireless or optical communication fields. So at the beginning, we know, of course, the advantages compared to RF. We have a lot of advantages, not only the high data rate, the large bandwidth, that is not the only advantage. Also, of course, if we compare to RF, we have always to consider the Fresnel zones, or this propagation area in RF. In optical wireless, we have a very narrow beam, yes? So we can have high intensity on this narrow beam, well focused, yes? And so that is also, of course, the advantage that we cannot easy, yes, be wiretapped. It is possible, of course, but not easy, as we know, yes? Not so easy like in RF. And of course, also the electromagnetic compatibility and the electromagnetic pollution is also are two keywords we hear all the time, and we, of course, have not this problem, not for the moment. Perhaps we have it later if everybody has the same optical frequency sometime, yes. Perhaps then we will also need some regulations, perhaps. But till now, we have the advantage that this is not necessary and not the problem. Of course, compared to the fiber, we have the only advantage that we are more flexible. Yes, we can have use it for mobile and nomadic use, but in principle it is the same technology like we use in the fiber. Yes, so there's not much difference. And as we know, all the advantages, but we have big disadvantage, and this is usually the local weather situation, because this local weather situation will influence our reliability and the availability of the system, the local weather, yes? And as we know and as we will see the bad weather condition, the worst case is the fog or the clouds, yes? Because of the drop sizes we have there. So that is the main bad situation, the disadvantage for our optical wireless systems we have. In former times, we classified the optical wireless systems, the outdoor optical wireless systems with beam-to-beam communication, not the multi-path or multi-scattered, multi-reflected beams, but the outdoor beam-to-beam, point-to-point communication, we classified in three different types. The one was the very cheap solution, scientific name, you should not so tell the low cost solution, but it is the low cost solution, yes, because for this solution we also developed such systems, started in 2000 by ourselves. It was very cheap, not so precise, and also plastic lenses and optical components, yes, and also of course of the electronic side we used the cheaper components, so that we could have a cheap solution for this optical wireless. And of course also the beam divergence is larger because you use it for short distances, maximum you have seen there 1 kilometer. And of course, because of the larger beam divergence, it is not necessary to have auto tracking, yes, because also if there is some building sway or something else, it is not a problem to use this system, because it is very easy to install and you have a larger beam divergence. Our system, two of them are visible here, they are they have a beam divergence of around 2 degrees. Yes, from millirad to degree at around 2 degrees. Yes, and you see the small system on the top, the example. Yes, it is only planned for 100 meter for really short distances. And it is equipped with light emitting diodes, because that is better in the case of laser and eye safety. And if we equip this 100 meter system with VCSEL laser diodes, which are also easy to install, we can come up to 200 meter or something. Yes, so we can reach double, in principle around double, of the because of the other beam divergence and the higher intensity of this VCSEL laser diode. We can come up of double the link distance. Yes, and the system here, the second system, you can see. You can see here the four on each side, the four small lenses. The four small lenses are the transmitter. They're behind this, on each of the lenses is behind a light emitting diode for transmitting, and or of course a VCSEL laser diode. And on behind the big lens, in the middle, it's around 8 centimeter. It is behind the photo beam diode. Yes, so also it's a better quality photo beam like photo diode, but it is a cheap component. Yes, so cheap to achieve these both systems. And these systems we see here, the system with the big lens, we used with light emitting diodes for 300 meter, and for with VCSEL laser diodes, we could come up around between 500 and 700 meter. That was not so. That was the range in between 500 to 700 meter. So nearly double by using these VCSEL laser diodes. And at the beginning, of course, when we had these self-developed systems, we had only the 10 megabit system, which worked perfect. It was the Ethernet, yes. And we also offer these systems not only with a fiber interface, we also offered it with this Ethernet connector interface, because that was more comfortable to connect two computers or one computer system from this building with the other one. Yes, so that was very comfortable. Yes, and then we also had a system that was the first step, because at this time when we have done this work, nobody was interested in 100 megabit or more. He said, oh, 10 megabits is enough. Yes, but in the meantime, of course, the data rate, the bandwidth demand, yes, is still increasing. Yes, and so we had a well-working system also for 100 megabit. Yes, but for 100 megabit, we know the problem is the light emitting diode is nearly at the end of working. Yes. Of course, you can have better light emitting diode, of course, but then you have a laser diode if you have a better working light emitting diode. So the physical border is around 100 megahertz or 100 megabit for light emitting diodes. And then we had also some prototype, yes, of a gigabit, because the 10 megabit was the Ethernet, yes, then the fast Ethernet for the 100 megabit, and then the gigabit Ethernet, yes, for the 1 gigabit. But at this time, when we made this work, it was much too expensive, because we had really to use much more expensive components. Yes, if we used only the cheaper solution, then we could only have some link distance working of not 300 meter or not 100 meter, only a few 10 or 20 meter. Yes, that was the disadvantage this time, because all the other components were not well enough explored, yes, to use it here. So we stopped with this 1 gigabit system at this stage, and then we also stopped with this self-developed system. We used our old, yes, but now since I think 1 year, we are still starting work on a gigabit system or more. Yes, but it is only one student working on it, so it will need time. But we also want to have it like a more cheap solution, not too expensive, and it should work. Yes, but we stopped this old system technology we stopped, I think, at around 2005 or something, because at this time, the time was not ripe for that. As we discussed before, photonic is not stoppable, but it needs time. It is still coming into the mind of all people. And of course, the type 2 and the type 3 system, the type 2 system is nearly the same, yes, like the type 1 system, yes. The only difference is you use more expensive optics and lenses, yes, and of course also the electronic parts and components are more expensive, and of course also the beam divergence is smaller now to overcome longer distances from 2 to 4 kilometers, example, yes. But then, of course, it is also the end of this type, yes. They are much more expensive because we will see later some evaluation results. We had such a type 2 system at around 2000. It is still at our institute, but we made a lot of experience with that. At this time, the costs were around 35,000 euros for a pair of system, for a system, for a pair of two units. Yes, so that was very, very, very expensive. And at this time, of course, this was working with, at this time with, did I not say a wrong number? It was, I think, 625 megabit. Was it working, this one? Yes. It was a good system, yes, but it was too expensive. Yes, it was from, it was some type of light point system, but not a light point. It was sold by some German company, I think it's GOC, you know it, yes. It was a good system, it is still working, yes, but too expensive, yes. And so that was also the reason why we thought at this time optical wireless would only make sense, because also we saw this influence of the weather would only make sense for the last mile area, yes, exactly for this broadband initiative. It would be of interest, yes, this connecting of the last mile, yes, of the last kilometer or last mile, yes, where usually very often the real high data rate is missing, yes, very often the fiber cable is near to your building, yes, but not direct in your building. So that was the idea why we concentrated mainly on this last mile access. But in principle, is type 1 and type 2, not much difference. Main difference, the angle and the price, yes. And on the type, we will see later for this type 2 some evaluation results. And type 3 is nearly there you can see that this is coming from the space technology, yes, like they use also for for satellite to satellite communication or satellite to ground. It is a similar technology with auto tracking, very small beam divergence, like you see here, 0.3 milliradians, and a really high concentrated beam intensity on this small and narrow beam. Yes, of course you can come up with some links for more than or up to 10 kilometer, like the German aerospace DLR has shown they had a link of 64 kilometers somewhere. Yes, it is working, of course, but not on bad weather conditions, as we know, yes. And also, of course, we have here mandatory this auto tracking that is necessary, but that is not a big issue in principle, because you have that also on the inter-satellite links and the optical inter-satellite links between satellite to satellite. You have also this auto tracking and it is perfectly working. But on some such a system, we saw that these atmospheric turbulences, yes, that they made really a big problem to the system, because you do not know if these atmospheric turbulences are coming up, yes. The light beam is somewhere directed in another direction, yes, some type of beam wander, yes, and then you do not know on these turbulences in which direction you have to work with this auto-tracking. And when the auto-tracking started to work, yes, then it was very often some only short-time failures, but we saw the short-time failures on the system, yes, because it was in summer times when we tested and evaluated such a system, and then we had these short-time failures because of this atmospheric turbulence. Yes, as mentioned, the reliability aspect was one of our most interest, and of course, usually if you have the whole system and you say about reliability or availability, then of course you have different influences. You have in principle the influence, of course, of the system, of the electrical and optical components inside, yes. Also, of course, of the interface and connection, you should not forget that. And of course, the link in between. And in between, of course, the local weather is mainly influencing the link availability, and that is one point we considered much more to develop and to investigate, of course. Yes, that was our main point. It was also the reason why we participated in this cost action 270, because this cost action 270 was on reliability on optical components, devices, and communication networks and systems. And when I was at the first meeting, then they asked me, I was the first one in optical wireless at this time, and they have been, all the people have been in optics. It was around 99 or 2000, yes. But they have not heard before a lot of people from optical wireless, yes. And they asked me, what you are doing in this cost action? I said, yes, there's written reliability. But of course, you see that reliability is really on different parts of the communication network. Perhaps one interesting point, if you say reliability, not always the optical wireless, or most of the time, not the optical wireless system is not working. Most of the time, some other systems, the interface or something else is not working, yes? Because we had two or three times, one time they said it was a system, we had some cooperation with the government of Syria, they gave us some money for research and then we installed their system, and then they called us and said, the system is not working. And then at first, of course, we are thinking, because yes, perhaps somebody has moved the system, or you have misaligned or something, yes. And when we came, we saw that the interface coming with fiber cable, yes, it was somewhere connected in the window, yes. What they told us, it is not, this window will not be closed or something at first, but then it was really under stress. In between the window, and then so the fiber was destroyed, not our system, yes? So they had, but at first the system is not working, that is the usual, yes? Or another point, also when they called us, some other cooperation partner, they said, the system is not working. When we came, it was, of course, it was the system, but not the optical wireless part, it was the power supply who was, has given up the life, yes? So to change the power supply. So there are a lot of influences on this reliability aspect. But of course, we mainly concentrated on this weather situation in between. Yes. And as we know from the aspect of reliability of the weather conditions of the atmospheric influences, we have of course this molecular absorption. Yes, the first part. Because we know we have molecules in the air, and these molecules have different lines of absorptions, yes, and this make these absorptions by the molecules. But these ones are stable nearly all the time. There's a difference, of course, on the height of the Earth, of the atmosphere, yes, but they in principle stable, yes. So this one you can always forecast. You know what is the absorption effect, what is the molecular absorption, which windows you can use or you should use. We will see in the part 2 later, yes, that we can see this different molecular absorption, but this is predictable because it is always the same, yes. And then, of course, we have the second part, which is not so good predictable because the scattering of particles, yes. And in scattering of the particles, of course, also the molecules, we have the scattering by the molecules. This is the usual, the Rayleigh scattering we have there, yes. But that is also predictable because the molecules are the same, yes, still nearly the same, yes. And the influence is not so high, yes. But if you come to larger sizes of particles, yes, then of course that is more worth of the optics, aerosols, fog, rain, yes. And of course, most worst situation is if the, because that is me scattering, and the most worst situation is if the particle size and the wavelength is nearly at the same size, yes, the same value. Yes, that is the most. That is the reason why fog, yes, and clouds, yes, are the big enemy of optical wireless. Yes, if we look to the RF, to radio links, then of course it is the rain. Yes, because the raindrops, the size of the raindrops, has the same value like the used wavelength in RF or radio communication. Yes. So that is the most interesting part we have to explore, we have to investigate in more detail, and these parts are done later in part 2 and part 3 of our lecture. And of course the third part, the atmospheric turbulences, I have mentioned it before because of these evaluation results, we will also see it later in a little bit more detail, but this is mainly You know this, I think all of you have seen these scintillations, these atmospheric turbulences, mainly in summer times, yes, if it is very hot, like now, and you look on the street or on big roofs of buildings, then you see this flimmering in the air, yes, and this is this atmospheric turbulences, because the refractive index, yes, in the air, of course, it's nearly one, yes, but it is not exactly nearly one, it is one dot, and then I think six or seven zeros, and then there's a change in the next position after the zeros, yes, and this light change, yes, is causing these atmospheric turbulences, because, you know, these air masses, they are moving, yes, and this moving means there's a slight different refractive index, yes, and in case of this, it is like we have a fiber, yes, some different refractive index in case of inhomogeneities. Yes, it is a similar effect, yes, like you have here with this atmosphere. But there is stable in the fiber, and here it is moving, yes, because of this refractive index change of the air masses changing around. And of course, if we use only intensity modulation, incoherent transmission, yes, then it is only the beam wandering effect and beam spreading effect could occur, yes? But of course, these atmospheric turbulences, they also change the wave, the phase front, yes? And if you use, as example, coherent transmission, that is also then the influence of this change of the phase front, you have also this influence by these atmospheric turbulences, yes? But for intensity modulation, then only the beam wandering and beam spreading is of interest. We will see later, of course. And as example, we see here now two of the systems. This is the mentioned system, nearly this old light point system, combined with an old directed radio link. Yes, it is. This system is still there, the optical wireless system, but the radio link, this directed radio, is not longer needed. We used such a system to connect our institute building, you see later, to a distance of 2.7 kilometers to an observatory. And to this observatory, we had only this connection by this directed radio and this optic wireless. That was the point why we used this type 2 system, yes, to show how it is working, yes. And we could also really see when we used this system, our system, because of the focused neural beam, had very well connection. But when there was some rain or wet weather, of course, then sometimes the radio link had problems because of the trees nearby, yes? And if they are wet, then they, of course, they have a high conductivity, yes? And so, because of these Fresnel zones, that was a real problem for this directional radio link at this time when we installed this system. And on the other side of the this is only for a schematic figure. We see here on the other side a system of type 3 with this auto-tracking system. We will see later in the evaluation. This auto-tracking system of type 3 was excellent. Yes, you had only to go on the top of our platform, we installed the system, and we had a rough direction, and then we pushed some button there, and then the systems found by themselves. Yes, it was perfect, yes. But of course, the atmospheric turbulences, they made some influences on that, so that we had some mistakes, some failures in summer times, yes. But the system in principle works perfect. Compared both systems, at this time when we bought this one, not we, our project partner, it was around 33,000 euros. This system, I think, was around 45,000 euros. So there was again some 10,000 euros more to pay for the Type 3 system. And on this system, because it was from Canon, yes, you could really see that it came from the technology from space, yes, like in optical intercellular links and so on. That was that what you could see on this link. And as mentioned, our main point is the weather, or main aspect is the weather influence. That has been our first measurements we have done within this coast action, within this coast 270 near Nice in France, because at this time, I think the coast action was running this time around 3 years. There was France Telecom, a partner. And at this time, France Telecom had a PhD student who was also working in this optical wireless field. And so he was very interested on to overcome these atmospheric effects. And so we had the first measurements in this. And one of my colleagues, perhaps Jan knows him, Michael Gebhardt, he is now with NXP company working in the RFID field after finishing his PhD. Of course, there was no fund or no possibility to hold him at the university. He changed from optical wireless to the RFID field, where he's also now a very famous senior scientist, yes. But he was there in France with equipment from there and own equipment to measure the attenuation of fog, yes. And the point is, of course, we know that there we have these attenuation factors here in between. There we have, of course, the molecules and the aerosols. The aerosols are these parts which are most influencing. And of course, we have the scattering and, of course, the absorption part. And in our case, if you have fog and clouds, the scattering part is the most important because that is the me or my scattering. Yes? And so, of course, we measured, or they measured there with own system. They had also some kinds of visiometer, yes, or that you can see how long is the visibility, because visibility is usually in optical wireless a very good parameter to estimate the quality of if the link is working or not. And so visibility is an important parameter, but they measured visibility with a visimeter and also a real transmission system built by our, or developed by ourselves to calculate the detonation there. And the very interesting point is, of course, we know these visibility models where you can calculate from the visibility side to the attenuation. And when they use this visibility model and they analyzed with our measurement, with the real experimental equipment for measure the attenuation, it was very well it was very well suited. Yes, they suited best to each other, and of course that was also a very good start for the work on these fog measurements in detail. Yes, because this equipment my colleague has developed for that, we used later in Graz, yes, also later on some other places in similar way, yes, so to analyze the fog in different cities in Europe. We have tried in this cost action and later, of course, also in this SATNEX European Union project. By the way, these are the usual model we have known, this GRUSE model and the KIM model. The KIM model is only an adapted GRUSE model with for shorter visibilities in more detail, yes. And perhaps you have seen later in the literature, the French colleague has a more detailed model. It was called this Maher Al-Nabulsi model. Perhaps you have seen it somewhere in the literature. Yes, it derived from there because this Maher Al-Nabulsi was this PhD student from Fast Telecom. Yes, we have worked together in this cost action. Perhaps you found it somewhere. And a very interesting point is, we will see it later in more detail, that as example, the fog in Graz, it is a more stable continental fog. I think it would also be similar here in Ostrava, in your city, yes. Compared to the city, to the fog near the sea, it is very, very different, yes. You can see only the changes and, of course, the attenuation, but of course later in the fog part you also see there's also of course a difference in the drop size distribution and so on. Yes, they have larger particles inside in the fog. Yes, like we have, and so a typical fog in Graz is around 30 degrees per kilometer. The highest fog we measured was around 100 degrees per kilometer. Yes, in there in this. It was a typical dense fog at 300 dB per kilometer, yes. And they arrived at, I think, around 800 dB per kilometer as maximum. But it changed very quick. Yes, the fog in Graz was very stable, but this one changed very quick. Yes, the reason is also because where they measured near Nice is on the coast side, of course, and it is also on a hill, or the coast is very, there's like a hill there. And so I think there was some, the type of fog was more like a type of clouds. Yes, because you know, clouds could also be very different. So this fog coming was more like clouds are coming. Yes, so that is the difference why there's so much difference between this fog in Graz and fog in Nice. When we later checked with other cities, it was mainly the continental fog similar to Graz. Yes, like we had in with Prague, cooperation in further cost action, or Milan and also Budapest, yes, they had similar attenuations like we measured in Graz, and this was really the seaside on the hill, it was like clouds they measured. And of course, as mentioned, that was later done and followed in the further satellite network of excellence programs. Here you see these two systems we evaluated, yes, again, yes, in more detail, but all the points I have mentioned before. And this system is still in Graz, because we received this system at around 2000, or 99, 2000, And it was, how can I say, it was like before the privatization, this English word, privatization, yes, of Austrian Telecom, yes, before they had an own department for research and development, yes, with this department, they gave us money for some measurements and analyzing, and they ordered this system from GOC. We said we have a link available for 2.7 kilometer, and then they offered us this link, and when we installed the link, we saw that it is, in the manual it was written only for 2 kilometer. And later when we looked on the website, they said it's only used, should only be used for 1 kilometer. And then we called our telecom and said, then you heard on the phone, stop, because they said, okay, we have made some mistake. I said, oh no, we want to see how big is the influence of folk. And that was the reason why they bought this system. And this system is still in Graz, because I think 1 year later, they started with this reorganization of the Austrian Telecom, yes. They also split it up, this research and development center. And I think 1 year later, they asked us if they could have back their system. And then we said, do you really need this system? Because you will be split it, and I think nobody will know. What will you do with the system? Then they responded, because we do not know what to do with the system. I think we will have somewhere in the cellar or somewhere. And I said, is it possible that you can leave the system here in Graz? And then I said, yes, it would, but you have to sign some letter that we know that it is in Graz. And then we wrote, we will have make further research with it, further investigations. And I think in the meantime, nobody knows that the system is still in Graz. Yes, that is the point. So I think all the responsible people will have been going to for retirement or left company or something. Yes. So that is the reason why the system is still in Graz. And the other system we had only for, I think, 2 or 3 months for Everate. Yes, this canopy system. And of course, perhaps that is not our task we have done, space application, but we are also very proud because in 2010 around, yes, we had our first ESA contract, our optical group, together with UNL Research, regarding ground to Earth optical links, and it was called Reliable Optical Feeder Links. And when we applied for this ESA contract, we applied because we have read Reliable. And I said, okay, if other will apply, they will not have a lot of experience in Reliable. So we applied together with UNM Research. UNM Research is a research organization near Graz. I think in former times they had names like Graz Research or Styrian Research, but I think you know it also, it is, I think, so half funded by the local government of Styria, yes? So that is a research organization, and they are much more familiar and famous with such contracts, with ESA contracts. So we decided to have them as a prime contractor, and we have been subcontractor, and we have had also some consultants, because these optical feeder links, like they called it, was mainly taught to use for broadcast, yes, that you only give high bandwidths and high data rates and a lot of data from ground to the satellite, yes, and the satellite should distribute this information with RF, of course, like DV, yes. For such reason it was used, and for such reason it was planned, yes. In, at first, when I saw this topic, I was not sure why should we, that it make no sense to bring high data rates up from ground to the satellite, and then you have to divide or to deliver it with the downlink in RF. Yes, for me, at the beginning, it has not made sense to do it in this way, but of course, there is some sense behind. Yes, because if you use for the uplink the optical high data rates, and if you can convince or if you can make it possible to use also the usual uplink RF frequencies for downlink, yes, that would be an advantage for the broadcast satellite. Yes, but I think for this reason you have also at first to convince perhaps the regulators, yes, and perhaps somebody else to use it. Yes, but that was the idea behind. Yes, and we were very proud that we get this contract in 2010. It was a very fruitful work, I think more than 2 years, because we get also some extension, some additional work package, because there was some, in ESA they have always some money somewhere as a reserve. If you can show to ESA that it is a benefit for them to have some additional outcome, yes, then they can give you some reserve. I think it is around 20% of the whole project, yes. So at the end it was planned at first for 2 years, but it was then 2.5 years, and we were very proud that we have get this contract from ESA. By the way, at the moment we have also applied for an ESA project. Hopefully we will perhaps also be successful, but it is really for space application together as a prime contractor, as a GNUNM research, and RUAG Switzerland, the optic people there, they are like we, the subcontractors. And it is also some combination plan between optic and RF, so perhaps we will be successful, hopefully, because that would be good for our group, of course. That is the reason why. But I think you know, everybody know this Silex experiment. That was very good experiment done at this time by ESA. Also, perhaps I should mention, before I mentioned that in Graz we had only a small group in optics and optical wireless, that was at our institute, and the years before in Vienna they had a big group in optics, optical wireless, Professor Leb, yes, he was very famous, and also they had a group in optical communication and networks in general, FANAS group, yes. And both of these professors has both have are retired now, and they have not occupied, or they have not given a chance to a new professorship for optics. So in Vienna, at the moment, there is not really optical communications done at the University of Technology, because both professors retired, and later they had one professor, but he was only called for networks or something, nothing in the name special for optics, nothing. Yes, so that is the point how it can change so big. I know one colleague very well. He was in the group of Professor Van Haas. I have a good contact with him. I think he's really the last who is doing optical communication at the University of Technology. Okay, now to this evaluation results. As mentioned, this is this 2.7 kilometer link between our institute here. That was wrong. This one. Our institute here and this observatory. Yes, and we had this link for permanent. This optical wireless link with this directional radio, and later for only 2 or 3 months, this canopy link also on the same platform, but a few, I think 10 meters of distance, both systems, so that they had a similar wavelength, so that they not influence each other, of course. And as mentioned, this link from this permanent link from bought by Austrian Telekom. This link was only specified for in the manual for 2 kilometers, and on the web, if you looked, only for 1 kilometer. So of course, if there was dense fog, then the failure rate was very high. Yes, that was the reason we can see now in the results. An example from the autumn in 2000, I think that was the time when we installed it the first time, till September 2001. We had, of course, failures in the time when fog occurs. It is not every year the same, sometimes also in September can the fog start, but at this time it was mainly November, December, also in January, because in Graz we have, if there is fog, then it's very stable. Yes, it is there for half a day or something. Yes, because we have on the one side of our city we have hills. Yes, and if there is no wind blowing up, then this fog is stable, sitting or laying near the hills over the city. Yes, but the last years we had not so often fog. Perhaps it is also that people take more care in winter, not for heating and so on. Perhaps that has improved a little bit, so we have not so dense fog. I always say the years 2000 to 2002 has been the most foggiest years at our experiments, but that was good at this time for our experiments here. And of course, you see there's a high rate of broken links, of probability of these broken connections in these winter times. But if you recalculate, yes, to 1 kilometer, like they guaranteed, then of course the reliability would be much better. Yes, but for 1 kilometer, such a system is too expensive. Yes, as we have seen, because for 1 kilometer that is too expensive to use such a system. Yes, but of course if you can forecast how it is working in some area, it is also an advantage for using this system. As mentioned here, the data rate is 155 megabit, yes, and they used 4 transmitter and 4 receiver. That is a, we call it also always multi-beam, because you have more than one transmitter or more than one receiving area. Yes, the multi-beam or multi-link system, they call it multi-link, but we say multi-beam because you have 4 beams in parallel, and that is also of course good against building sway and against these atmospheric turbulences, because if you have only this beam wandering effect on atmospheric turbulences, then it is much better to have 4 beams instead of 1, yes, to overcome these atmospheric turbulences. As mentioned here, if you calculate or recalculate from the 2.7 kilometer to the 1 kilometer, it is much more better. Yes, you can see here it's a worst case around 80% in December. Here. And all the other values are much more better. No, the black is no. The 80 before is now the worst, nearly 87. Yes, so it's much better. And all the other values increased also by much 41 kilometers. That was like they guaranteed, yes. But as mentioned, for 1 kilometer, it's too expensive, such a system. So it is better to use two chip systems, in serial connection or something, would make much more sense, yes. Or like we have done, we will see later, some other types of modulation. Here we measured these atmospheric turbulences, and we measured these atmospheric turbulences exactly when we had this experience with this canopy system. Yes, because we thought, what is the point or what is the reason why this canopy system always had these short time failures in summer? So we measured such atmospheric turbulences, and of course if you only count the attenuation, that is if you have only use intensity modulation like we are using, then of course this change in the intensity, yes, is well analyzed and well suited to the results you can find in the literature. Yes, that was the reason why we have done these measurements. And here you can see this kind of beam system nearby, yes, on the other corner of this platform, yes, and this is only, of course, a mono beam system. You have only one transmitter and one receiver. You have this auto tracking. The data rate, of course, is the same, but because of this auto tracking and space technology and this very focused beam, yes, is of course this system much more difficult to use against these atmospheric turbulences. I think that's the slide. Yes, it is not high, this probability of failures, yes, it is only 1%, but of course it is summertime, yes, and usually for the other systems, you have in summertime no failures, yes, but in this case, of course, you have in summertime failures because of this atmospheric turbulence. Only a low number of failures, yes, but these losses, these short-time failures, that are generated by this atmospheric turbulence. Of course, what can we do against this in our current investigation? One point is to use hybrid links to combine optical wireless with microwave. Yes, the point is because they have not only different weather influence, there is also a different propagation behavior, and of course, the benefits we will see later will sum up. Yes, only the benefits will sum up and not the drawbacks. Yes, only the benefits. That is the advantage we have to combine these systems. We have also done that in a lot of experiments, and that is also, I think, at the moment very popular to combine optical wireless with RF links. Yes, because optical wireless links are becoming a little bit cheaper, yes, microwave links becoming more better and also cheaper, yes, so that is a good time now also for these combinations. And of course, one point is modulation and coding technologies or techniques, because in optical wireless, most of the time we really use still the stupid intensity modulation, yes. Like we use also in the older systems in optical fibers, yes, because it is enough. For the bandwidth, we have enough bandwidth available. Till now it is enough, yes. But we know in other technologies, like in RF, they have to use other modulation and coding techniques. And so we also used some type of this modulation and coding technologies in optical wireless. Yes, one very good attempt is this pulse position modulation, because of course the laser eye safety is defined by the time where the laser pulse is effective, and also of course by the intensity, yes, and of course if you make in the same time slot, like defined in the laser and eye safety regulation, a shorter pulse, yes, then of course you can increase at this time the intensity value, the maximum value, yes, and that is the point of using this pulse position modulation. But of course, there's also a drawback. If you use this, the data rate is lower at this moment. If you use, instead of on-off keying, as example, 256 ppm, the data rate is lower, yes, but otherwise you can overcome longer distances in dense fog. Yes, we will see later some of our results. There we have had some, for example, this 256 ppm, we could have a chain of around 20 dB, and that is if you have in Graz's example in fog, dense fog for 30 dB per kilometer, and you have 20 dB more on chain, yes, so you can have perhaps additional 500 or 700 meters you can overcome the fog instead of using on off key. That is the very interesting aspect. And of course also site diversity, yes, also perhaps as example in this ESA contract, we had also the discussion what happens if there is a lot, if there is fog or a lot of clouds in between the ground station and the satellite. And then we discussed whole Europe is well connected with fibers, yes. If there is somewhere else a ground station, yes, in the meantime the other ground station can bring up the high bandwidth to the satellite, yes. So that is also a point to use site diversity. And also, I think usually if you say, if you make a correlation of the weather and you say if you have weather on the location A and weather in location B, then I think around, they calculate with around 500 kilometer, then it is nearly completely different from the weather situation on both locations, from fog and cloud influence. If you are in our regions, like we have mountains and so on, it could happen that there is a big difference in only 100 kilometer, that there is fog in one city and no fog in the other city. Yes? So that is very good also to use this site diversity. Of course, we have always to increase this transmission capacity. Gigabit system, gigabit per second systems, like I mentioned, we stopped it at around 2005, but now, of course, we have again started with gigabit system development, because now the need is here for additional data rates, yes? Because 2000, everybody said, 10 megabit is enough. We will not need 10 megabit, only 100 kilobit is enough, yes? But now, of course, we know the demand is increasing and it has changed. And of course, wavelength division multiplex systems is also one point to increase, and also such systems of this wavelength division multiplex for optical wireless has also been developed, I think, in 2000 in US. But as we know, in US there's a lot of money behind, mainly from military side. They give a lot of money for such experiments and for some research. Yes, it is also, if you see ESA or NASA, then there's also a big difference, and ESA is always long steps behind the NASA, mainly from the budget side. Yes, not from the research and this side, but from the budget side, they are very long behind the NASA, of course. And of course, one point is also always to increase mobility and to include it to indoor optical wireless, because if we say hybrid systems, then we can of course mean combinations like we have here with optical wireless and microwave, but you can also combine optical wireless with fiber optics, optical wireless for outdoor with indoor, yes, or as we discussed before, visible light communication for illumination is very more becoming popular and more and more of interest, yes, also for communication and for broadcast data. Yes, so that is a very interesting aspect we will see also in the future. All the work, of course, has been done in past time by our students. At the moment, only two students are working in the optical wireless. One on the outdoor optical wireless and one on short-range indoor optical wireless from the PhD students, yes? Because of less available budget all the time, yes? So that was our system for this gigabit, as mentioned, for this gigabit Ethernet, but we stopped and we started half a year ago with some new ideas on this gigabit system. But that was the old system, the same housing, yes, but only for gigabit, but at this time, 2005, it was most too expensive, yes, to work on this, yes, because the time was not ripe enough for high data rates, as you know. And as mentioned, modulation encoding, to use in feed this on-off keying, what is the same with the 2 dBm, 2 level pulse position modulation, we can use some higher order of BPM, higher level, and we used as example this 256 pulse position modulation, and we had a chain of 20 dB compared to on-off keying, and also we used some type of coding. We will see on, I think, on the other lecture on some figure. Some type of coding, we could also we have an additional chain of 5 dB. Of course, in coding, you have always to, I'm not a specialist in coding, but you have to take always the most suited coding scheme if you have a modulation scheme. Yes? And if I remember correct, but you will see the slide, we used some type of Reed-Solomon coding, I think, for this 256 pulse position modulation. Mm-hmm. And here, of course, is the principle. You see here at the same time slot, the time slot is from 0 to 2, yes? You can have for 2 ppm and on-off keying, you have only this D half pulse, yes? And then you can reduce the pulse to D divided by 4, and then you have can have, of course, the double of the power. Yes, that is the idea behind. And of course, if you have this 256 ppm, you have divided the time slot in 256, this 0 to 2, instead of 2 or 4, in 256 small slots, and only in one slot you send high data rate. But of course, high intensity. But of course, the data rate will decrease, of course. Yes? Because of, but it is better, of course, if there is dense fog, yes, to have instead of 1 megabit, still perhaps 100 megabit or 10 megabit, then you have no connection, no link availability. That is the idea behind. And of course, I told you a nice slide now for combining RF system and optical wireless system. They have, of course, different propagation characteristics, and also the weather influence and the atmospheric influence is completely different. Yes, because if there is fog, then the fog is mainly influencing our optical wireless system and not the RF system. Yes, the rain is nearly not affecting or not highly infecting our optical wireless, but of course the RF link, the microwave link. Yes? So the combination is perfect. We have a lot of advantages and disadvantages, but only the advantages are summed up for the benefit of using such a hybrid system. But of course, if you say hybrid system, you can combine also other technologies. Yes, but we had this analysis of RF and optical system, optical wireless system. As example here, we had at this time, we had at the same building and the same link we have seen before at our institute to the observatory in Lustbühl. We had parallel to our optical wireless link and ANS link at this time. It was till 2003 when we made the experiment. And then you can see, of course, the single reliability or the single availability of both links are sometimes very low. Yes, you can see here in springtime, sometimes fog, of course, and sometimes dense rain. Then, of course, the rain is infecting mainly the microwave, that is the black solid line, yes, and the optical wireless or free space optics link is the dashed line you can see there, yes, and of course in one or two months both availabilities could be lower, but not at the same time, yes, because it is very seldom that you have very heavy thunderstorm in summer and very dense fog at the same time, yes, perhaps you have sometime like vapor in the air, but not dense fog like you have in winter. So that is nearly not possible to have at the same time that both links are not working. Yes, and so you see the hybrid overall availability, and this number is a very good number. This 99 0.926%. That is a really good number, because we know the telecom providers always tell us the five nines, yes, but we see three nines available. And if you calculate what that means, five nines for this number, that is nearly nothing in the year. Yes, but there is some really some failure within the link. Yes, so that is a very high rate of availability if you use such hybrid systems. And as mentioned, the optical wireless systems are becoming cheaper, and also, of course, the RF links are cheaper now and better. And so the combination is a very well idea to do that in parallel. Also, by the way, at this time when we developed our system for short ranges, nearly never in the world have been available systems for short link distances for 300 or 500 meters. Yes. Now, if you look in the internet, you will find much more such systems available for 300 or 500 meter or maximum 1 kilometer. And of course also much cheaper than at this time when we had this contract, this research work with the Austrian Telekom. Mm-hmm. Also we demonstrated some of our links in corporations. Of course also with the government of Styria, I think we had two times the good luck to make some cooperation with the government of Styria. Cooperation with government of Styria, you know, is always, if you have cooperation with government, that means you will also receive money, usually. So that was a good and fruitful time. It was not, there's not been big projects, but it was a good local fund we had at this time. And on one of these contracts, we had also to connect different organizations for a civil-military cooperation exercise, and this was in 2004. It was called Schutz 2004 or Schutz 04. Schutz means protection. It was civil-military cooperation, and the point was all the organizations had a good internal equipped communication media or platform, yes. Also the military and also police and fire brigades and everybody had their own system, good system, but they could not cooperate with the other always, yes, because you know, for the military that is so secret, we cannot cooperate or cannot phone with the police or something, and also from police side. So we had to establish these links in between. Yes, there was a military command in Graz, and this military command was connected by our optical wireless systems to the police command, which was nearly neighbored, yes, of Styria, and also of course to some other places. We had some nomadic mobile stations with satellite and optical wireless. That is also a possibility to combine RF and optical wireless, not only in parallel for higher availability or reliability, also in serial connection. Yes, because at your NEOM research and the neighbor institute of Kudelka, yes, they had a mobile satellite earth station, an RF, yes, this one, on some vehicle to move, yes, and in former times when they made somewhere such a mobile video conference, this was for, used for video conferencing systems, then they had of course from the ground station, they had to use fiber cable to the indoor place where the video conference would take place, yes. And that was sometimes hard work, also for the, always for the people to have 100 meter of fiber cable. Yes, it was like in military they had similar, yes, with fiber cable. So we connected this system with our optical wireless system. Yes, as example, we had in Vienna at the UN city, UNO city in Vienna, there was some telemedicine event, and on the ground floor, somewhere on the parking place, was this satellite earth station, and from there to the 9th or 10th floor, we connected with optical wireless. Optical wireless on the 9th or 10th floor was somewhere in a room, yes, behind the window, indoor, because that is also an advantage. With optical wireless, you can go usually easy through windows, yes. With RF, you have sometimes a problem, because some of the glasses, also mainly in cars, they have some metallic layers inside, and then so sometimes RF or microwave is not passing these glasses, yes. But optic or light is very well passing also these glasses. So we could use it to connect this ground station to the 9th or 10th floor. And from there, it was still not enough, we had to go somewhere in the lecture room, yes. And the last few meters, we used WLAN, but at this time WLAN was very new when we used it at this time. We had a very big antenna, very big concentrating RF antenna to go with high RF intensity through the rooms and walls to the lecture room. Yeah, so we had really used this as a serial connected system, optical wireless, satellite, RF, yes, to connect some places. And the point was, you could also do that for very mobile and nomadic use, if there is also for, that was the reason for this civil-military cooperation, because usually you have some flood or disaster or catastrophe somewhere, and then you can use such systems for such video conferencing or other communication system. So that was well done at this demonstration. You can see a few figures. You see here some military people. Jan, I think you know Andreas, our system administrator of our institute, who is in civil there near the military persons. And here you see the satellite ground station. At this time, we had still our own car, our own institute's car, this white car there, which was moving this satellite ground station. And of course, on SatNex, we had also done some other experiments in unmanned aerial vehicles and high altitude platforms. But so far, we have never seen a real working high altitude platform for communication. And the idea started, I think, at around 2000. Yes, where they said there will be big platforms over big cities for communicate. So we had also done some work there within this SatNex frame, but also with ERDS Astrium, or ERDS, now it's called Airbus again. It's changing the name. I have a colleague there who told me, I think, but that was before the last two changes. It's now his fifth name, so this will be now the seventh name or something, but of the company, but he has never changed his office. So that was some study we have done. You know, these unmanned aerial vehicles, they are, I think, more of interest at the moment than higher altitude platforms. Because they use it for, also you see, also the big Amazon or Google, they always wait, they will have their unmanned aerial vehicles, and they will also, I think, Amazon would use it for divide his puzzles by these unmanned aerial vehicles. That looks very future. But I think it is more and more becoming of interest. Yes. At the time when we cooperated with this ERDS Airbus, we had also some discussion with other company and for some unmanned aerial vehicles. And then he said, what does your system, what are the costs of your systems? And then we told him what are the real costs of optical wires. And he said, okay, if the system would be the size, half of the size now, yes, and the weight would be perhaps 5 or 10 parts smaller than now, and if the price is half, then we will buy your system. So you see, sometimes discussion partners have not realistic ideas what you are doing, yes. In principle, of course, from the commercial aspect, he is right, yes, but... Okay, there has been some tries for connecting some UAV swarms and so on, but I think it is not so of interest because this work is also back now more than 5 or 6 years. And of course, I mentioned this ESA contract we had, yes, and as mentioned, these optical feeder links that would be of interest if you can really use both RF spectrums for the downlink now. Yes, then it would be really useful to have an optical feeder link, yes, for feed the satellite, the broadcast satellite, with peak data rates. And if you can use for downlink, not only the RF link you use usual for downlink, if you can also use the usual uplink RF frequencies, then you can double, of course, your data rate, yes, and your capacity. That would make sense, yes. And as mentioned, we are a little bit proud because we have got this contract at this time. I think the main point was really the reliability aspect, yes. Because if there is not, it is important to have this system always available. With my colleague from German Aerospace Center in Oberpfaffenhofen, these guys with the 65 kilometer link, they mainly concentrate on atmospheric turbulences. Of course, if you have such a long link, yes, the atmospheric turbulences are really very high influencing your link. And then when I asked them the first time, but what you are doing if there is fog or if there are dense clouds? And then they smiled and they said, we will wait for better weather. But that cannot be the view of a communication scientist, because we know in communication it is important that we have good quality link nearly 100% of the time. Yes, so this aspect is not important. This aspect that they will wait for if the fog is clearing up is not useful for us. Okay, this was this contract. We mainly analyzed these atmospheric influences and optical frequencies. That was also the point when we, because before we measured only, of course, the fog attenuation and the fog influence. Yes. At this step, of course, we saw it is also important to know something more about the clouds. Yes, the types of clouds, the concentration of the particles. Yes, and so that was the reason we had also an own MATLAB model for calculating. For an optical wireless link, the link availability with the link budget, yes, and so we included there in this MATLAB model also attenuation by clouds, and this attenuation by clouds we could receive on some parameters. There exists some parameter in Europe called ERA 15. I think you have heard perhaps from this data. They can tell you in different zones, different waves of the Earth, nearly all parameters of water vapor, pressure, and so on. Yes, and from all these parameters, you can of course also calculate the cloud density or the cloud attenuation. Yes. And that we have done and implemented this interface for this data into this MATLAB model. Yes, but that was in this step that we extended our MATLAB model, yes, for clouds also. Yes, and of course we have done it How can you do it the best? We had different, we could implement in the MATLAB model different layers. You can say on the ground layer we have with this thickness this density or these parameters, and in the next we have this. So up to 10 different layers we could introduce in our MATLAB model. Yes? And we know the troposphere is ending at around 10 or 11 kilometers. So fog and clouds only can appear in this region, and above there are no clouds available, so that should be enough, these 10 layers in this MATLAB model. That was the idea behind. And of course, future work, cost activities I have mentioned. I think now the current cost action, the IC1101, is nearly finishing. I think there's the last meeting in Istanbul. I have not so much contributed, I think, in this running cost action, because I had not enough resources. But in the former cost action, this was the 0802, that was a very fruitful, because that is also very important sometimes. There was some combination of microwave people and optic people, yes, and there have been 3 working groups, and 2 working groups have been in the RF microwave field on the propagation side, and the third working group was in the optical wireless propagation, weather influence for this optical wireless. That was the third working group. So that was a very fruitful, and I think all the people from there also went into the new cost action. But as mentioned, I have not so much contributed in this new cost action like before in 0802. And of course, we have tried to involve always in projects, not only for our research, as we know. We need research for our colleagues and for our PhD students to fund them, yes, to get enough resources and finances, to have enough money available that people can work on their PhD. Okay, I think the first part is finished, and I think it is time now for a good break for the next part. As mentioned, these are the parts I can contribute to give some lectures or some talks, but mainly for today I will have in the second part atmospheric influences, that will be at around 1 hour, and the last part, the fog influences, will be a short part. Yes. 10 minutes or 15 minutes, what will you need?
10 minutes.
Oh, I think 10 minutes enough? Okay. Because I was now longer than 1.5, so...